Good morning, those of you joining us online. I want to say welcome to you as well. What a great opportunity that we have to be together and to really kind of put a punctuation point on the end of the series where we've been studying Philippians. Now, I want to open with a question. Here's a question. Have you ever tried to do something good for someone that turned out to be bad? Think about that for just a second. Have you ever tried to do something good for someone and it turned out to not go so well? And if you're married, the answer is probably yes. You know what I'm talking about. Or if you have kids. If you have kids, you know what I'm talking about. I remember one morning trying to surprise my kids. They got up early and, you know, I was like, okay, I'm going to make one of my girls some toast. And I thought, okay, I'll make her some toast, but then I'm going to put sprinkles on it and I'm going to surprise her, right? And it's going to be a fun thing. Like, hey, she'll have, you know, cinnamon sugar and some sprinkles. And so I make her toast. This isn't a huge deal. I understand. But I'm going to make her toast and then I put the sprinkles on it and I put it in front of her. And meltdown, right? Like, sprinkles! Like, why is there sprinkles? I'm thinking, that's a good thing, right? Apparently not. Apparently not. I'm not even going to get into any of the spouse things that we try to do that are good. I'll just say it's just happened once or twice, where you think you're doing something good, and it turns out bad. And if we're all honest together, we probably have situations like that, where we've tried to do something good, maybe at work, maybe at home, and it turned out to not be good. That's the equalizer. We've all had that. But the bigger question this morning, and maybe one that takes a little more work to get an answer for, have you ever experienced something bad that turned out to be good? Have you ever had an encounter, an experience that at the beginning was awful, and you looked at it and you thought, oh no, how in the world am I going to recover from this? How am I going to get out of this? What's going to happen? This is on a terminal velocity. Nothing good can come out of this. And maybe a week, a month, several weeks, maybe years, maybe it's still in limbo, but it turns out that there are blessings. And there are things hidden in those. You know, this book of Philippians, Paul's writing from a jail, right? We've talked about this. We've gone through this whole book. Paul's writing from a jail, and how can anything good come out of that? Yet I remember early in the series, Todd showed a bunch of images on the screen, and he showed tattoos and coffee mugs and t-shirts where people had leveraged verses in Philippians and were still clinging to these words of this letter. Hey, Paul, you sat in jail and you got some t-shirts and some tattoos out of it. Turns out there was some good things that came out of Paul's time there. I don't know about you, but I've been encouraged over these last 12 weeks. I've been encouraged reading God's word, reading Paul's letter to us, and being reminded that he's writing from a jail and he's telling us to take joy. Because even out of the bad things, there can be some good things that can come about. And I think Paul, throughout this entire letter, was trying to instruct us and lead us and guide us on how to discover joy, so that joy can remain in our life. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to land the series today. We're going to end our time together. We're going to finish the book of Philippians, and then we're going to close out our time together by experiencing communion. And Jenny already told you guys at home, hey, grab some elements. It doesn't have to be anything fancy, you know, something like a cracker or something that you can, you know, you can consume there, a little piece of bread maybe, and then some juice. It doesn't have to look like, you know, the juice that we're going to have, coffee. I don't care what it is, but for you to just kind of have that thing that you can engage your senses at the end of the service. And those of you that are in the room, you should have found those somewhere on your seat. We're going to end our time together experiencing communion. But before we do that, let's look at Paul's final words in the book of Philippians. I'll pick up a little bit where Denny left off last week in verse 20. He says this, to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. That's what we got last week. This great reminder that we can do all things and that God is with us. And then Paul kind of concludes his letter and he lands with, "To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen." And so you think, okay, that's the end. He ends us with an amen. And what we're going to cover today is this last little section. It's almost like the PS in the book of Philippians. Because he lands it and he says, amen. And then it's almost a little bit of a PS. Oh, hey, by the way. And we get this last part of Philippians. So let's continue. He says this. After he says amen, his PS begins with this. Greet all God's people in Christ Jesus. The brothers and sisters who are with me send greetings. Now, audience participation, for those of you that are in the room, those of you that are online, you can fill it out. You can put that in the comment section here. Where was Paul? This is a quiz. This is to check your active listening. I've already given you the answer this morning. If you've been here for any part of this, you should know the answer to this question, okay? Where is Paul writing this letter from? Anyone, where's he writing it from? He's writing it from prison. So Paul's writing this letter from prison, and he says, greet all God's people in Christ Jesus. The brothers and sisters who are with me send greetings, which means the brothers and sisters who are with him are also where? They are in prison. How is it then? And this is, I love God's word. This is why the study of God's word is important, because I've read the ending of this. Like, to just read the ending of Philippians is one thing. And I've done this so many times where I just read it and, you know, it just kind of rolls around in there and then goes away and I don't think much about it. But in this week, as I was studying this passage, he says, greet all God's people in Christ Jesus. The brothers and sisters who are with me also send their greetings. Paul is calling his fellow brothers and sisters. He's calling his fellow prisoners. He's calling them brothers and sisters. Not, hey, these jokers that I'm stuck in here with. Which, I'll be honest, you know, people I work with sometimes. No, I'm teasing. Sometimes I take that approach to the people that are around me. Like, oh, these people around me. Whether they're believers or not. And Paul is writing to encourage the church at Philippi. He's letting them know, I'm in prison, and while I'm here, hey, I've made friends. Like this one guy in here, you're not going to believe what he did, but he's actually not that bad. And as I got to know him, I shared my faith with him. And guess what? This guy that I'm in here with, he's no longer a prisoner. He has claimed his allegiance to Christ. He's now on our team. And I was telling him about you, and he wanted to send greetings. You've never met him, but he wanted you to know. He says, hello. How cool is that? Paul, in the place where he was, even in prison with other prisoners who were probably in there for different reasons that he was, they were probably, some of them were some bad dudes. I mean, it's like, who knows what they were in there for? And Paul buddies up to them. And he was like, hey, you've got a story. I've got a story, but what's your story? And he hears their story, and I'm filling in the blanks here. We don't know this, but I'm like, how do you get to the place where you call your fellow brothers and sisters, or your fellow prisoners, brothers and sisters, and then they want to send greetings to other believers? How does that happen? I think the only way that happens is Paul has moved towards these people, these prisoners, these people that have done bad things, really bad things. It's gotten them into prison, and Paul buddies up to them and realizes they have a story. And Paul introduces them to Jesus. So here's the question. One of the questions that this ending of Philippians stirs in me. When I look at other people around me, people in the community, people that I hang out with, people who I don't hang out with, people that I see when I'm driving down the street, people that I see when I go to a store, people that I see and it triggers some sort of response in my mind where I'm making up their story. How do I see them? Do I see them as a prisoner, or do I see them as a brother or a sister? Honestly, that kind of haunted me this week. When I'm thinking about Paul's words and he's in prison, he says, hey, all the brothers and sisters that are with me, they want to tell you, hey. Paul no longer saw them as prisoners. He saw them as his brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm still thinking about Sam's message several weeks ago when he talked about unity. Paul, a big theme in Paul's letter that we get here is unity. And Sam stood up on the stage and he talked about unity, bringing us together, and how as followers of Jesus, we have to be together. And do we even see one another on the same team? How many churches did you drive by this morning on your way here? I would encourage you, when you're driving by a church, another local church in town, and you see it, and maybe you read their sign, maybe you see their building, to say a prayer for them, because you know what? They're on the same team. They're after what we're after. They are our brothers and sisters in Christ, serving together. As the global pandemic was weighing down on all of us, late February and early March, I had the privilege, and I honestly mean this, I had the privilege of being asked to represent you with a couple of other of our pastors on staff on a weekly call, weekly Zoom meeting. We all had to figure that out, right, in a hurry. On a weekly Zoom meeting, where about anywhere from five, sometimes as little as few as five, to as many as 15, or I think maybe 18 at the largest number, pastors were getting together every Friday. Pastors from this community were getting together every Friday on Zoom to think about our community, to plan, how can we help? How can we support one another? How can we support organizations in this community? Some people would throw in, well, hey, we've got this and we can offer this. And some folks would say, look, we can do this, we can't do this. And somebody would say, yeah, but we can. And they would chip in. And for several months, they came together and we got to know one another. You see, we've all tried to do good things that turned out bad. But have you ever been a part of something bad that turned out to be good? I don't want a global pandemic. I don't want people to die. I don't want people to get sick. But I got to tell you, in the middle of that, in the middle of April, when I'm meeting on a Friday morning on a Zoom call with a bunch of squares, I don't mean they're square, I mean like squares, right? And I'm seeing these pastors who I'd never met, and we're coming together and we're praying together. You ever been a part of something bad that turned out to be good? Because that's what happened. I got to see that. And hopefully you can squeeze some stories out of the last several months yourself and say, wait, God's been doing something. Because Paul tells us, hey, I'm in prison with these guys. This one guy, nobody goes near him. But he's actually not that bad. And he wanted to tell you, hey. Paul saw them no longer as prisoners, but as brothers and sisters. He goes on in this letter, in his closing, and again, he uses this phrase, all God's people, and he says, all God's people here send you greetings. So the prisoners, he's already identified the prisoners, they're our brothers and sisters, and then he gets even bigger, and he says, all God's people here, where he's at, they send you greetings, especially those. Now, here's where my head goes. When he writes, especially those, so Paul, we call him Apostle Paul. He was called by God. I mean, God spoke to him, wrecked him in the book of Acts. You read through the book of Acts, like God struck Paul blindness 3 days. This is a guy who had a conversation with God. God calls Paul to reach a group of people, everyone who's not a Jew. That's Paul's calling. That's big. That's not like, go to Warsaw, Winona Lake. No, everyone on the planet who's not a Jew. Paul gets that directly from God. So when he says, all God's people here send you greetings, especially those, my brain goes to, oh, Paul's going to list then the people that he's partnered with. These Paul's going to go to the special list of people. He says, all these people, especially those, and he's going to call out, he's going to give like this shout out, right? especially those, hey, those who, you know, been working over here, you know, in Corinth, want to, you know, they want to greet you, go Corinth, and all those people over here, like, especially those, and hey, one of my buddies, you know, I just want to give him a special call out because, you know, when I was in town, like, they took me out to Ruth's Chris, was awesome, like, I want to call him out, like, yeah, especially those, he's going to call those people with special honor. Look at what he does. He says, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. Pump the brakes for just a second on this. Those people in Caesar's household would have pledged their allegiance to Caesar and not to Christ. If you're in Caesar's household, you are under his authority. You are surrendering to him. You are saying, my Lord, that's what they would call the king, the emperor. They would say, my Lord is Caesar. And yet Paul, while he was there in prison, had influence on his fellow prisoners and also those in political authority and also those who were ruling over them and who at one point had claimed their allegiance to a person, which, by the way, if you go back in the book of Exodus and you read through the Ten Commandments, that's one of the first ones. That's a biggie. And Paul had influence on them. How do you have joy in the midst of your circumstances? Paul apparently stayed committed to God. He clung close to him. And then he changed his surroundings by saying, oh, you're not a prisoner. You're now my brother and sister in Christ. And he led them to the Lord. And then those who were ruling in authority over him, who were oppressing him, who actually had him locked in jail, he looks at them and he goes, hey, you want to be on my team? You want to change your environment? We influence the people around us. Paul gives special call out, not to the pastors and preachers and teachers and those who had taken care of him. He gives a special call out to those who had once surrendered their lordship to someone else and had now surrendered to Christ. Which brings me to this thought, and I've got to be careful with this one, I know, because it could backfire on me horribly. I'm just going to make a confession here. October, not sure if you're aware or not, October is Clergy Appreciation Month. It's a special day in October called Pastor Appreciation Day. If you're unaware of that, I want to make you aware of that. And I can't stand it. Can't stand it. Makes my skin crawl. And some of you are like, wow, he really doesn't like celebrations. Wow, look at, this is weird. Here's why. If you know the history of Pastor Appreciation Month and Clergy Appreciation Day, it's rooted in another writing that Paul gave in 1 Timothy, where he talks about giving special attention and a double blessing to teachers and preachers. Like, at its core, it's good. Because Paul was saying, like, hey, they're laying some things on the line, and they're going to these towns where, by the way, they may get killed, beaten, thrown out of town. So Paul's trying to kind of throw them a bone. So I get that. But the history of Clergy Appreciation Month goes all the way back to 1993. All the way back to 1993. Where somebody who worked for Focus on the Family, which is a great organization, right? They've done a lot of good things for the family and the church. Somebody at Focus on the Family said, you know what, pastors, I don't know, maybe their brother-in-law was a pastor and had gotten beat up and, you know, like, you know, people in the church were saying bad things about him, and not that that ever happens, but, you know, that, you know, maybe he was frustrated. And so they, you know, they identified back in 1993, well, let's give that a whole month. And it got some traction on radio stations because Focus on the Family had a radio ministry, and all of a sudden October became Clergy Appreciation Month. And then Hallmark picked up on it. You can actually go online. You can read this. Hallmark, you know, grabbed onto what Focus on the Family was doing and said, we'll release an entire line of appropriate greeting cards for people. And if you've ever sent me one, that's not, I'm not offended. I appreciate that. But here's the thing. They jumped on it and they found a way to sell more greeting cards. And then Christian bookstores got on board and were like, we've got a whole line of products and calendars and things that we can do. Here's my beef with it. Here's the problem. There are men and women in sunlight this morning who have sacrificed their time and effort and energy to invest in the lives of our children this morning, right now. And there's not a small group leader appreciation month for those men and women who are down there investing in our kids. There's not an entire month dedicated to those of you who give your time in this community and you share the love of Christ with the people for free. There's not an appreciation month for the small group leader who will show up at youth group, not just tonight, but next Sunday night, and the next Sunday night, and the next Sunday night, and will go to a kid's high school graduation, who will sit at a middle school girls' seventh grade basketball game, which takes like 9 hours, and they score 3 total points. You know, that they will go to one of those games just to support a middle school girl so that they have the opportunity to speak into their life one day. And there's no month dedicated to them. They don't get a day. Hallmark's not spitting out a greeting card for a seventh grade girl small group leader. And yet they're doing ministry and teaching people about Jesus. Now, don't get me wrong. I'll take all the gift cards you want to put in my inbox. But Paul is saying this. All God's people here send you greetings, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. You know, Paul's entire ministry, and if we look back on this letter to the church at Philippi, Paul's entire ministry was leveling the playing field and saying, prisoner or pastor, it doesn't matter. Whether you've at one point literally surrendered your life to another God, or you grew up in a home where you only knew the true God, Paul's leveling the playing field. He says, Jesus came for all of us. Every single one of us. And then he ends with this. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and your spirit. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. And it seems and feels like kind of a trite, like, well, that's kind of an appropriate way to end this letter. And I think it's super appropriate, because if you look at how Paul started this letter and how we started this journey 12 weeks ago, Paul opens his letter with this. Paul and Timothy, servants of Jesus Christ, were writing this letter to all God's holy people. Sound familiar? To all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with all the overseers and deacons. Look at how he opens the letter. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The bookends of Philippians. The bookends. Paul opens and closes Philippians with grace. The bookends of Philippians are grace. The beginning and the end, grace. What if our lives were bookended with grace? What if our days were bookended with grace? What if every email we sent was bookended with grace? What if every social media post we sent or posted, or every picture that we posted was bookended with grace? What if every interaction that we had with the people in this community was bookended with grace? I wonder if joy would not only remain in our lives, I wonder if it would remain in the lives of others as they interact with us. The ministry of Jesus was one of grace. And this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to end our time focusing on that ministry of grace. We're going to close Philippians, and what we're going to do is we're going to think and stew and focus on that grace. A couple weeks ago, we read this passage out of Philippians that Paul writes, and he says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is excellent, whatever is praiseworthy, whatever is admirable, focus on these things. This morning, what we're going to do is we're going to take just a few minutes and we're going to do that. We're going to focus on what is true. And here's what's true. Jesus Christ came to earth as a baby, lived a perfect, sinless life, died a criminal's death for you and for me. 3 days later, he got up out of the grave for us, proving that he has power over sin and death. He rose up into heaven, sent his Holy Spirit who lives in us and gives us power to walk this planet to be his representatives of grace here on earth. That's what we just sang this morning. I believe in God the Father. That whole song was the theology of what we are practicing this morning and what we're remembering this morning. Whatever is lovely, I can't think of a more lovely act. Whatever is noble, he didn't need to, but he did. Whatever is pure and excellent and praiseworthy, if there's a reason that we give him praise, it's because of what he did on the cross. Paul says to focus on these things.